something more about the technology. I would like to state that let's keep the discussion today completely technology related. Technical questions will be very, very welcome. This is also based upon our own research here at WARI. So we encourage that you do ask questions, we do discuss, but let's stick to technical discussions about HAT, and commercial and financial can be done at a later time, or as we do plan to have this series going on way forward. All right, Kavish, you can take it.
Right, thank you so much, ma'am. All right, let's move ahead then. What is heterojunction basically? Why do we, what do you say when you mean by heterojunction? So heterojunction is basically combination of more than one PN junctions or more than one junction which are put together. Okay, so heterojunction is basically a N-type wafer-based crystalline cell which is packed in the middle, and on top of it you have amorphous layers on both the sides, right? So it is basically a combination of both crystalline and amorphous nature, or crystalline and thin film. Crystalline modules are something which you see usually on the field, probably from mono or poly. And thin film still has a small portion, but we still know what thin film is, right? So this heterojunction is combination of both amorphous and crystalline silicon. The idea was that because crystalline nature has better light absorption, okay, so that's why we use crystalline, we use the crystalline silicon, and amorphous nature has superior passivation properties, right? So utilizing both those properties in a single cell, that's what makes a heterojunction cell, okay? Going ahead, you know, giving you a typical advantage of heterojunction, heterojunction is not made with the typical high temperatures, what you see in the crystalline solar cell, but it is made at lower temperatures. So soldering or module making happens at lower temperature, right? Then cutting a heterojunction cell into half, because people have now started working more on half cut cells or cut cell modules, cutting the heterojunction cells into half or other pieces, we see that there are less number of micropries generated when you compare it to other the other PV technologies, right? Third, heterojunction cell is only 150 microns thick, which is compared to the other PV silicon technologies, which are somewhere close to 180, 190, 170 odd, right? So you are minimizing the utilization of silicon and other materials. And let us look at the advantages. I mean, next slide. Right. So first and the foremost advantage, what we told you, that heterojunction does not have any LID or LETID, right? The formation of heterojunction is such that there is no boron, which is used in the heterojunction, making a heterojunction cell. Hence, there is no LID. When we talk about LETID, LETID is a known phenomenon where hydrogen has a major role to play in LETID, but because we do not use any hydrogen here in manufacturing heterojunction cells, that's where you find no LETID in it, right? We have a comparative graph, which is from Eternal Spire, where they have compared N-type and P-type, right? We see P-type, of course, having more LETID. When you compare it to N-type, N-type still has, N-type for it still has LETID, but it is at the lower level. And HJT, when you see HJT is the flat line which you see, which revolves somewhere around 0%. So that means that there is no LETID, right? Let's go ahead. Right. So let's talk about, we already talked about LID and LETID. How do you know that there is no PID? Okay. So that is obvious from the picture on the right. Well, you know, we have compared, there's a comparison between the typical crystalline silicon and the HJT PV module structure, okay? PID or potential induced degradation happens because you have charge accumulation on top of the cell, or you have ions coming on from the glass or from the frame or from the glass to on top of the cell, which are, they are sitting on top of the cell, or you have electrons which are going out and via the frame are getting grounded. So those are the two mechanisms of PID. And the main concern here is that we are using a SINX or a ARC coating on top, which is of SINX, of course, which is polar in nature. So that SINX enables or promotes PID in a way, right? Because it accumulates charges there, and that's where you have the leakage current. Okay. When we talk about HJT module, because you have a TCO, which is transparent conducting oxide, which is made up of ITO, which is also, okay, right, it's mentioned here. So because it is bipolar, because it is non-polar in nature, it does not have any charge accumulation on top of it. That is where you see that there is no PID involved, or you do not see any PID in the heterojunction modules or heterojunction cells. Okay. Right. Next, what we also saw in the heterojunction, the layer or the cell mechanism, how the cell is made between that N-type crystalline and between the crystalline and the thin film layers of heterojunction, you have something which is known as a transparent layer. Or so that promotes or internal resistance of the heterojunction cell is such, it has better VOC and fill factor, right? It also has better passivation, which leads to lower recombination. Okay. So due to this two reduction, because of this better passivation, which of course leads to lower recombination, and because it has less internal resistance. So that means that cell has a better VOC, or VOC is open circuit voltage, and a much better fill factor when you compare to the other PV technologies, right? So all these reasons are combined together, all this technology, all these advantages are combined together, and that's where we have very good temperature coefficients in the HJT cells, right? And overall, because we have no LID, no LETID, no PID, and further because it has lowest temperature coefficient, the degradation or the overall degradation rate, which is seen in HJT, is very, very low when you compare it to P-type perc or N-type perc, right? Let's go ahead. Right. So let's talk about what are the changes that are needed when you are utilizing HJT, right? This is more at the module manufacturing level, but this is still something which we wanted to show you, okay? At cell level, HJT has quite advantage because it just needs to be, or HJT is manufactured only in 6 steps when you compare it to your multi busbar or PERT, which needs typically 10 steps, right? You have time saving, or the number of steps are saved, right? At module level, HJT is in default bifacial in nature. So that means that you would have to shift to bifacial modules, and bifacial modules are also coming up. But this would indirectly mean that you need to utilize BOE. A BOE is a better version of encapsulate. And you would also have to change the rare cover of the module, because typically we are all using white backsheets till now, right? So you would rather need a transparent backsheet or a transparent glass at the backside, right? One important thing what we want to highlight here, and this is taken from Eternal Spire again, that anyone who is utilizing a HJT module would need an upgradation in their flasher, right? This is because heterojunction has higher VOC, and that leads to the HJT cells or heterojunction cells having higher capacitance. So to mitigate those capacitance, we need to flash those modules or flash the cells if you are using at 170 milliseconds, right? If you flash it below 170 milliseconds, you would get a power output which is not in the accurate range, or not correct, right? So if you flash it above 170 milliseconds, the error would hardly be less than 1%, which is in acceptable limits, right? So these are the changes required, right? Let us very quickly do a comparison, a technology-based comparison, right? We have taken all the currently available technologies worldwide, P-type PERC, N-type PERT, N-type TOPCon, which you hear now, and we have also taken N-type HJT. Right, bifaciality, HJT has one of the highest bifaciality numbers. We have seen that in field, we write greater than 90% here, and when you compare it to other competitors. But what we have seen on field is that you get probably somewhere around 95% bifaciality when you use a HJT module, right? Micro crack resistant, we have both TOPCon and HJT in this list, right? Both of them are micro crack resistant because we have MBB coming in. But HJT still has an advantage here because you are also utilizing MBB. We are utilizing multi-bus bar, and we are also utilizing crystalline on the middle and thin film layers on both top and bottom, which gives it flexible, which makes it flexible in nature, right? At both power degradation rates, as I already explained to you earlier, because there is no LID, because there is no LATID, we usually don't find any initial power degradation. And even at long-term, power degradation rates are much lower when you compare it to the peers. LEDID, LID are already taken care of here. Low light performance. One of the better advantages of HJT is that it has amazing low light performance. So that means that in the early morning hours or in the late evening hours, when you have, say, for an example, your regular modules cutting in, say, in the morning, if you're, we all know that we need a minimum voltage to kickstart the inverter, and only then the inverter will be able to, you know, convert the DC to AC power and all that, right? But because HJT has very good low light performance, that would typically mean that you can expect very good voltages or very good power output in the early morning hours or even in the late evening hours. So that means that you have better energy generation both at the morning and in the evening, and you have increased span of your energy generation, right? One more thing, what I want to tell you in comparison and what we have not captured in the table is that it has very low temperature coefficient, right? For the country like India, where we usually sit on the temperature ranges above 40 degrees in summer, HJT can be a very ideal choice. And I would come to that. We would have a typical comparison between PERC and HJT. But let us look at roadmaps and where the entire world is going, or what is the world saying about HJT, right? So on your left, you have efficiency roadmap. At efficiency roadmap, we have a comparison between P-type multicrystalline silicon, P-type mono, TOPCon, and HJT. We see HJT being a clear leader, right? And on the right hand, when we see bifaciality and when we compare the normalized power of M6 modules, we see that expected bifaciality or the bifaciality what we expect in the coming years is 95%, which I told you about HJT, right? For TOPCon and your typical PERC, it stays well below 90%, right? So these are the advantages, or these are the roadmaps for efficiency and power. We see in all the three terms, efficiency, module power, and bifaciality, in all the three things, HJT is a clear winner, and we see HJT as a prospect, as a strong prospect, I must say, in the near future. Next. Right. So temperature coefficient in the left, as I was telling you, here in India, we have all the type of weather, right? We have hot and humid, we have warm and humid, we have cold weather. But most of the India, where we see, apart from north and northeast, in summers, the typical temperatures, at least at ambient weather, are somewhere around 40 or 42 or 43 odd degrees, right? And that means that your module operating temperature is much higher, right? So when you compare typically poly, mono, IBC, and HJT, HJT has much lower temperature coefficient. That means that, say for an example, if you had a 100 watt module, your temperature coefficient was 1 degree, 1% per degree Celsius. So every rise in a degree Celsius, your module power output would reduce by 1%. So for an example, if we have degrees as the ambient temperature, that means that module operating temperature is increasing, say for an example, by 1 degree, the power output of a typical 100 watt module would be 99 watts, and so on, right? So we see that HJT has lowest temperature coefficients, right? And this is also proven from the right hand, where, you know, we did a comparison between HJT and PERC. We see HJT as a clear winner. Okay, on the in the right graph, on the left hand, you have specific energy, which is in kilowatt hour per kilowatt peak per year. On the right hand side, we have percentage plot. Okay, We are plotting specific energy here, performance ratio, and P velocity to temperature. All in all the three terms, specific energy for HJT is much higher. It is more than 100 units higher per kilowatt peak per year, right? Performance ratio of HJT is 5% at an absolute value, almost 5% higher when you compare to PERC. And temperature losses are lower at an absolute 4% when you compare PERC with HJT, right? So we see HJT as a clear winner. And this low module operating temperature also leads to the gains in specific production, what you can see here typically, right? Let's go ahead. Now let's see where the world is, or where is world at heterojunction, right? Because we see a lot of PERC, or we hear a lot of PERC. We now are starting hearing a type of TOPCon. So let's see where the world is at HJT. Okay. Till 2020, the capacity and productions were close to 5 gigawatts and 2.6 gigawatts. In 2021, the scenario has changed. We have almost double the capacity of HJT and more than doubled its actual production, right? And when we see the announcement, or when we follow global announcements, we see that more than 50 gigawatt capacities, more than 50 gigawatt of capacity is already announced. So probably within 2 or 3 years, you would see that HJT taking over the entire market. And we also feel that the shift what we saw from mono to multi, we would see a much, much sharper shift from P-type to N-type. It's just the matter of time, and it's just the adoption at the downstream level that we are waiting upon, right? Right, so what is the conclusion, or where are we at HJT, or what do we see about HJT? So HJT modules, as we know, are all the degradation mechanisms free, LID, PID, LETID. So that's a much needed relief for investors, you and end customers, of course, you, because now you don't have to worry about any degradation mechanism. We, of course, have better return on investment, better LCOE with the ideal bifacial modules, because we have bifaciality of more than 90%. Oh, temperature coefficient, as we had seen in the graph, is somewhere close to 0.25 percentage per degree Celsius. So this means it's an ideal choice for hotter climate in places like India. And we have low degradation rates. I mean, we have seen typical degradation rates for HJT varying somewhere around 0.2 and 0.25% per year. So this means that you are guaranteeing more generation, guaranteeing more power output, and at a longer time, you would have better power output when you compare it to the other technologies, right? So that's all from our side.
Yes, thank you, Kavish. Thanks for the presentation. We welcome any questions.